نحمده ونسلي ونسلم على سيدنا ومولانا محمد رسوله النبي الأمين المكين الحنين الكريم الرؤوف الرحيم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال الله تعالى في كلامه المجيد وفي القرآن العظيم ومن الناس من يقول آمنا بالله وباليوم الآخر وما هم بمؤمنين يخادعون الله والذين آمنوا وما يخدعون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا ولهم عذاب أليم بما كانوا يكسبون وإذا قيل لهم لا تفسدوا في الأرض قالوا إنما نحن مصلحون ألا إنهم هم المفسدون ولكن لا يشعرون صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected brothers, my sisters upstairs, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله تعالى, by the grace of Almighty Allah جل مجده, we are here today in Al-Mustafa Islamic Cultural Center to perform our weekly obligation of Salatul Jum'ah. And today, Alhamdulillah, it is the first Jum'ah of the month Zilhijjah. This blessed month, the sacred month, is the month which is associated with two things. Number one, it is associated with the Hajj. It is associated with the fifth pillar of our faith, of our deen, which is the annual pilgrimage, Hajj. Hence, millions of people have already started their journey towards the Holy Land, Makkatul Mukarramah, so they may be able and they may perform the Hajj this year. Similarly, this month is also associated with Eid, Eid al-Adha, which is the Eid of Qurbani, Eid of Udhiyah, Eid of sacrifice. Both these, the Hajj and Eid, are somehow related, even though one Hajj became compulsory 8th year of Hijrah, approximately. And Eid became wajib, and Eid was celebrated way before even Hajj was introduced to Islam. But in, I believe, the second year of Hijri, six, seven years before that. But they are still relevant and they are still associated due to the important position of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam in both, in Hajj as well as in Eid. But today, on this Zilhijjah, I'm not going to speak about Eid. Inshallah, after the Salatul Jum'ah, I will give some instructions for Eid, but that's it. Today I would like to, in front of you, mention one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this hadith is relevant today because we are living in a time of fitna. We are living in a time of fitna, which means a time of chaos, a time of distortion, a time of confusion. We are living today all over the world, Muslims now, they are one way or another, unfortunately, they are being blamed for the injustices, atrocities, barbaric behavior, un-Islamic behavior by those who claim to be Muslim. And I'm referring here to the organization the whole world is talking about, and it is in the world media, known as Daesh, or IS in English. ISIS also, Islamic State. Currently in the news, we find a lot of articles about them. But at the same time, there is some confusion in the minds of some Muslims also. Not only some non-Muslims, unfortunately, associate the behavior of this un-Islamic organization, which in fact has nothing to do with Islam, which in fact has nothing to do with the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people, they are associating it with the deen, the faith of Islam. And let me tell you one thing. There is no doubt that these people are doing a greater damage to our faith, Islam. They are doing a greater damage, causing greater damage to Islam, to our faith, these so-called Muslims. And they are not even 1% of the 100% of the Muslim population. They do not even represent 1%. But yet they are, at this moment, they are damaging Islam more than the a'da of Islam, the uduv of Islam, those that are invading Muslim countries, those that are invading Islamic countries, Islamic land, for wealth, for natural resources, or any other reason. Their damage is not justified, but their damage is nothing compared to the damage that the IS is doing. Why? Because these countries, when they invade Muslim lands, they destroy Muslims. They destroy who? People, isn't it? Muslims. But these people, IS, they do not destroy only Muslims when they kill. They do not only destroy Muslims, they do a greater damage than that. They try to destroy the image of Islam in the world. Islam becomes damaged. And this is why it is important to talk about this, that what is its reality and how do we look towards it, especially when there is confusion. I have met here in Ireland some of them, not a lot, but I have met some that are confused or that have somehow some kind of sympathy towards the Islamic State, this so-called Islamic State, Daesh. I shouldn't say Islamic State, they are Daesh, that's it. We call them Daesh. Islamic State, they don't deserve to be called Islamic State because they're absolutely un-Islamic. I have been approached, as I said, few months ago by a youngster, youth here in Ireland who uttered his desire of joining this group in Iraq. And he said, and I said, why? And he said, so because for Khilafah, for Islam. And obviously I then sit down with him and I explain to him the reality of these people. So alhamdulillah, he changed his mind. He never went. But there are dozens of youngsters from UK, from Ireland, from France, girls that have traveled to Syria and Iraq because in their mind, they believe that while they are joining this group there, they believe they are actually joining Islam, the cause of deen. While in fact, they are not. They are only joining not the Islamic State or Islamic group. They are joining the satanic state. They are joining the satanic state, satanic group. They are not Islamic whatsoever. And I will now tell you with Quranic reference, with proof from Hadith. And these people who join them, they don't even have ilm of deen, understanding of deen. And they are just Google Wikipedia imams or youngsters, youth, shabab. They go on internet, forums, And they learn a little bit this hadith, a little bit that hadith, and then they misunderstand, misinterpret it, and then they say, now we are going to go and we are going to spread Islam. Well, it takes ulama, people of ilm, 10 years, 15 years just to understand the Quran, just to understand hadith sciences. They spend their lives. And even then, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he studied for 17 years. And somebody asked him, can you give me a fatwa? Imam Malik, Sahib Mu'attar, can you give me a fatwa, ruling? And Imam Malik said, no, I am not yet qualified to give you a fatwa. 17 years he studied. He is the one who laid down the foundations of the Maliki school of thought. But after he studied 17 years, somebody came for a fatwa. He said, not yet. I'm not ready yet. I'm still a student and I'm not ready to give a fatwa yet. And these people, they study one or two books and then they become people that give fatwas. This is haram, this is shirk, this is tawheed, this is risala, this is Quran, this is hadith. What Quran hadith? You don't know nothing about Quran and hadith. You don't know nothing about Quran hadith. You are an idiot. You are a stupid idiot who thinks he knows everything, who thinks that I know Islam. But the reality is, the verse of the Quran, these verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, apply on people like you. Allah says about these people, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. There are people who say and who believe, we are believers, we believe in God, we believe in the Messenger, we believe in Akhirah. But Allah says, وَمَا هُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. They are not believers. Allah says, and then Allah says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ. Do these people, when it said, لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Do not create chaos on earth. Why are you killing people? Why are you spreading injustice? They say, إِنَّمَا نَحْلُ مُسْلِحُونَ. Oh, we are just merely doing islah. And Allah says, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ. They are not doing any islah. They are doing, in fact, the fasad, fitna, chaos, in the name of Islam. And Allah, أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ مُفْسِدُونَ وَلَكِنْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. And they don't know and they don't realize that they are the ones that are actually creating fitna. In their minds, they believe they are the one that is supporting Islam, supporting the cause of deen. But they are the ones that are damaging the cause of deen. The great son-in-law of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who actually in his own life was the great warrior against the fitnas, against these Khawarij. He was the great warrior against the Khawarij. He happened to be martyred by the Khawarij also. Who are Khawarij? They are people that claim to be Muslims. People that say La ilaha illallah. People that have beards. People whose apparent is as you would expect a Muslim to be his appearance to be. They are those who pray. They are those who fast. But وَلَيْسَ فِيهِمْ مُؤْمِنْ. But they are not believers. The Khawarij are the biggest danger to Islam and the biggest danger to mankind. That IS, Daesh are the biggest danger to Islam and biggest danger to mankind. And I'm going to tell you one hadith only, in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has pinpointed this group 1400 years ago. You know, these people, by the way, they just, and you know, they have black flags. You know the black flag they have? And they write kalima on it, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. In the time of the Sahaba, they never had any particular kalima. They never put the kalima on the flags. This is a great injustice towards the name of Allah. Flags will be on the ground. Why would you put Allah's name on a flag? It's not Islamic. It's absolutely not recommended to do so. Ali ibn Abi Talib narrates this hadith and he says, Qala, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّايَاتِ السُّودِ. When you will see the black flags. And you know, these people, the Daesh, they say, we are people of the black flags. Because in hadith, the black flags are narrated, mentioned as people that will come from Afghanistan and will be supporters of Imam Mahdi alayhi salam before the end of times. This is one of the signs of the people of Haqq. truth. But this hadith is not about Daesh. But they implemented on themselves. They say it is about us. And people who have little knowledge, when they read this hadith and then they see the black flags, they say, wow, look at them. They are the people of Haq. Oh, Allah ke bando, you haven't studied whole Quran or hadith. In the hadith, there are two groups of black flags. You are only looking at one hadith, one black flag. There is another group the Prophet told about who will have black flags in the Prophet. He warned us against them. He warned us, Rasulullah warned us, stay, be aware from them. And the signs, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّايَاتِ السُّولِ فَأَلْزِمَ الْأَرْضَ فَلَا تُحَرَّقُوا أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَلَا أَرْجُلَكُمْ. He says, when this group of people will emerge with the black flags, stay where you are. Do not move your hands and your feet. Meaning, don't go and join them. This is Rasulullah, this is metaphor. They don't go and join them. Stay where you are. You live in Ireland, stay in Ireland. You live in England, stay in England. You live in France, stay in France. Don't go and join them. The Prophet warned us against them. He says, these will be people. ثُمَّ يَزْهَرُ قَوْمًا دُعَفَاءَ لَا يُوبَوْ لَهُمْ. He says, this group will be consisting of youngsters. Look at YouTube videos. All of them are youngsters. All of them are youth, youngsters. 20s, teenagers, 20s, early 30s. And the Prophet ﷺ says they will be stupid youngsters. The word he used is stupid. They will be stupid youngsters. And then he says that قُلُوبُهُمْ الْحَدِيدِ, their hearts will be like stone. They will be stone-hearted. These people will be stone-hearted. Look at the videos on YouTube. How they, la hawla wa la quwwata, you know, kill people. Not only that, how they then put their heads of their people they have killed, then put them there for display on the gate so people will see and be afraid from them. Did this happen in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam? No, it never happened. Even the war against the enemies, he forbade the people of Iman, the believers, to even dishonor the dead bodies of the enemies. He forbade this. And look at these people, what they are doing. This is what Yazid did, by the way. This is what Yazidi armies do always. Yazidi in the sense of the one who fought against Imam Hussein. Remember, they were also saying La ilaha illallah. They were also praying in Karbala. But they are the Khawarij also. Similarly, they were Khawarij. And they did the same. They chopped the head of Imam al-Hussein radiallahu anhu, and then they put it on display. Look, we have killed Imam al-Hussein. Na'uzu billahi min zalik. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يفون بعهد ولا ميثاق. These people cannot be trusted. Because there will be no way you can make a commitment with them. Negotiation with them. They will turn back. And then he says, يدعون إلى الحق. وَلَيْسُ مِنْ أَهْلِهِ. He says they will call people to the truth while they themselves will not be of the people of truth. Which means they will call people towards Islam while they themselves will not be on Islam. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he says, أَسْمَاؤُهُمْ أَلْكُنَى. أَسْمَاؤُهُمْ أَلْكُنَى, which means their names will be, not their names will be like kuniya. Like for example, if somebody's name is Ahmed, he will not say I'm Ahmed. He will say, if he's a father of, for example, Muhammad, he will say Abu Muhammad. Like Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, huh? The so-called Khalifa al-Shaytan. Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they will introduce themselves with their kuniyas. Not only that, then وَنِسْبَتُهُمْ al-Qura, and the last name will not be of the tribe. Will not be of the tribe. The last name will be of their area. This is why Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. Now they are, by the way, this is another fitna. You know, when they see hadith and they see that we don't fit in it, then they try to fit in the hadith. Because in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, when you see a khalifa of my lineage, Banu Hashim, Quraysh, then you must accept him. Referring to Imam Muhammad Mahdi alayhi salam. This hadith has been understood by all ulama. as Imam Mahdi. Not before Mahdi somebody comes and says, I'm Qurayshi, I'm Hashimi, now I'm the Khalifa. No. Until the day of judgment, remember, there will be no Khilafa anymore. There's a hadith of Imam Bukhari, in Bukhari, that Khilafa is only 30 years. Summa malukuhum, summa malukuhum. Then after that, it's all rulership. Khilafa will never ever come anymore. Except when Imam Muhammad Mahdi comes, alayhi salam. But that doesn't mean if Khilafa doesn't come, then there will be never Islamic ruling everywhere. That, by the way, that doesn't mean that. Islamic ruling, you don't need the particular name, Khilafa, then it means Islamic. You can have a state, a country in which Islamic system is enforced, where basic human fundamental rights are given to everyone. Christians, non-Muslims, everyone. And that could be an Islamic state, ideal Islamic state. But you don't need a title. We don't, like many things in Islam, now we have names, but they weren't there in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Titles do not mean anything, by the way. Like Muhaddis, you know Muhaddis, Mufti. Do you know any Sahabi who was Mufti Abu Bakr, Mufti Umar? Just think about that. Or any Sahabi who is known as Mawlana, or Al-Allama, Al-Shaykh, Imam, Muhaddis, Faqih. No, they are titles, they don't mean anything. Because the essence is what is behind, the ilm. It is not title. So then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَشْعُورُهُمْ مُرْخَاتُ كَشْعُورِ النِّسَاءِ. And their hair will be like the hair of women, tall, long. Look at the YouTube videos. All the hair are long and curly, and their beards. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, يَخْتَلِفُوا فِيمَا بَيْنَهُمْ. And even they will fight among each other. Exactly what Daesh is doing. One group is fighting against this Iraqi group, Iraqi against the Syrian group. ثُمَّ يُؤْتِيَ اللَّهُ الْحَقَّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come a time, Allah will give, truth will come out. So don't worry about that. These people do not represent Islam in any way. Their conduct, their behavior of killing people on the base of their faith. I mean, Islamic history is testimony of this fact, of the beauty of Islam, that despite hundreds of years have passed, still in Syria you have the Syrian church. You had the Syrian until these people came. Hundreds of years in Palestine, Christians are even now living with Muslims together. Hundreds of years. It's a testimony of the fact that Islam is not against minorities. In fact, it protects the right of the minorities. It is these people who claim to be Islamic, but they are absolutely un-Islamic. And we, as the Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, must first of all understand the fitnas. Be aware of the fitnas. Without understanding them, you cannot save your iman. You must save your iman. It is the most important thing. And the iman of other people around you, it is your duty and responsibility. Don't be just too much busy in fulus and fulus and fulus in this country. While there are people next door to you, neighbors, who do not know what Islam is, and the only thing they know is through the media. You are responsible to give the true message of Islam. And I ask the ulama, I ask the Muslim leadership and Muslims in this country, why do you protest when a German newspaper makes a cartoon of Rasulullah, caricature of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Apparently you come all on the streets. But when this group of IS is damaging Islam more and more and more than that particular journalist, why are you not going out on streets and protesting now? You should be the one speaking against IS. But unfortunately, we are not doing that. Why? Because there is confusion among Muslims. Not leadership, public, common people. They still think, some of them, when they hear the name Islamic State, they think, oh, you know, it's an Islamic State, they must be right. It's absolutely not an Islamic group. The way they butcher people. Millions of people in the past few weeks, they have entered the borders of Turkey from Kurdistan and from Afghanistan and Iraq. Millions of people. Their fathers, children have become orphaned. Just, just imagine for one minute. Just 1 minute, just imagine this. When you look at the orphans, when you look at those youngsters, men being killed, hundreds of them together, when you look at how they are being butchered, just think, if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is watching this, if the Holy Prophet is watching this, what will he do? What will his response be? What will his response be? Rasulullah, that messenger, when he hears about Khalid bin Walid, he went to a place and there he met some non-believers. And the non-believers, he killed them. Khalid bin Walid, the Sahabi, companion, he killed them. While some of the people, the Muslims, they didn't kill him. Then they said, no, no, we're not going to kill them. Why should we kill them? Khalid bin Walid killed them. He came back to Medina. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is told about what Khalid bin Walid did. The first thing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does is he turns towards the Qibla. And he raises his hand and he cries and he says, Ya Allah, Wallah, I am free from what Khalid has done. I am free from what Khalid has done. I never told him to do so. And Khalid bin Walid was condemned by the messenger in such a way that the scholars, orientalists in the West, they say that since Khalid bin Walid was condemned by his messenger, by his prophet, for killing the minorities, from then until today, Muslims have always treated the people of non-Muslims with kindness and compassion and mercy. This is the messenger of Allah, that who is our prophet. And look what in the name of Islam is happening. So it is our duty and responsibility to speak out against it. Please don't only, I am the biggest person who condemns the invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq by the, and let me tell you one secret. This Daesh did not come from nowhere. They are always created, like Osama bin Laden was created. They are created. How else are they able to have weapons of millions and millions of dollars? Where do they get it from? They are created by the same people who then are fighting against them. This is the irony we are living in. They are created by the same powers that are creating them. Then their same powers are going to now fight against them, invade them. And who is suffering? It's the common man. It's the public. It's the ummah. It's the Islam. It's humanity. And what are we doing about it? That is the question. What are you doing about it? Just think about that for the next 1 week until next week, Jumma. What are you doing? Millions of people are in Hajj right now. MashaAllah, they have gone. May Allah accept their Hajj. Millions of people are gone. We are all united on Hajj. When we come back, we will again be disunited. That is the fact. The biggest thing what we can do is, first of all, when we talk about fighting, because this is what these people are doing. These people are fighting, killing in the name of Islam. Let us just study the Quran. Study the concept, the doctrine of jihad. In fact, qital, not jihad. Jihad is not even fighting in war. No, it is not. Jihad, juhud, jahada, it comes from struggle. It has many meanings. Jihad in the whole Quran, Allah never refers to jihad as fighting. This is what we use. We use, when we say jihad, we think of fighting. But in the Quran, wherever the word jihad is used, it is not used for the meaning of fighting. War, not at all. Allah uses a different term there. Qital. For jihad, jihad is used for bin nafs. Jihad bin nafs, jihad bin ilm, jihad bin qalam, etc. But for fighting, Allah never used himself jihad. Allah didn't. Jihad means literally struggle. In the Quran, when we look at the permissibility of war, fighting, the first verse Allah revealed, when Muslims were allowed to fight, أُذِنَ لِلنَّاسِ, that now the people have been given permission, granted permission to fight. When we study the verse, we find that in that verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the reason, justification for war. Why are they now allowed to fight? Muslims when they were fighting. Why were they allowed to fight? The amazing thing is Allah doesn't command in the Quran, you must fight. Like for Salat, Allah says, Aqimus Salat, you must pray. Zakat, he command, hukam. It's not, jihad is not hukam. Jihad itself, the fighting is not revealed as in a hukam. No, it is revealed as a permissible act that is only allowed under certain conditions. And the condition Allah mentions are the reasons, justifications. One of them is that these are people, يُخْرِجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ. The reason why they are now allowed to fight is because they were taken out of the homes. Their basic human rights were taken from them. And then the reason is religious persecution. Because their only fault was because they said, Allah is one. Allah says in the Quran, the reason why the Muslims were allowed to fight is because they were taken, driven out of the homes due to the fact that they said Allah is one. Which means they were religiously persecuted. Muslims were, and due to religious persecution, because Islam condemns religious persecution. Not just of Muslims, no, even Christians, Jews, Hindus, non-people of no faith. To prosecute anyone based on their beliefs is against Islam. Islam is the one, the religion that speaks so strongly against it that it is the reason why the Muslims were allowed to defend and fight. Because of religious persecution. And then Allah says the reason, if Allah would not have given the permission to the believers, there would have been no temples, no synagogues, no churches in the world anymore. Which is amazing, this verse. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the same time mentions that one of the reasons that you are allowed to fight is if you do not fight, there will be no temples, no churches, no synagogues. Question is, why didn't Allah just say there will be no mosques? Because according to these people, you cannot be a Yazidi, you cannot be a non-Muslim, a Christian. I mean, forget non-Muslim. According to them, you can't even be a Sunni. The Daesh are not Sunnis, by the way. Let you know, Daesh is IS, they are not Sunnis. Do not be confused. The media calls them Sunnis, they are not Sunnis. Wallahi, they are not Sunnis. They are those that are extremist Khawarij. That's it, they are Khawarij. They have nothing to do with Sunnis. They are prosecuting Sunnis. And Shias, of course. But the reality, and who are they? They are of a particular doctrine known as the Wahhabi doctrine. It's the reality. They are all produced by the same doctrine. They are not Sunni. Now what happens is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran mentions that Muslims are only allowed to fight when they are being prosecuted or when others are being prosecuted to defend them, to help them, to support them. But this group, so-called Islamic State, they are the ones that are persecuting people on the basis of the religion. So they are going directly against the Quranic verse, commandment, hukam. So how can they be Islamic State? They can never be Islamic State. This is one thing. The other thing is, what I want to share, it's very, very shocking and disturbing. Because one of the things you must know, everything that is happening, has taken place, or will ever take place until the day of judgment. And even on the day of judgment, everything has been already mentioned by the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, there is a hadith by Huzaifa al-Yamani. He says that once Imam Bukhari narrates it, he says once Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood on the minbar from the morning, Fajr time. And whole the day he gave us a speech. And in that speech that lasted until the evening, the Messenger of Allah had mentioned every single incident, every single fitna that will occur until the day of judgment. And he says, وَحَفِزَهُ مَنْ حَفِزَهُ وَنَسِيَهُ مَنْ نَسِيَهُ. And whoever has remembered, and whoever has forgotten. Which meant the Prophet has done his, he has warned us all. And whoever has remembered, he has remembered. And among those people was Sayyidina Ali Karamallahu Ta'ala Wajhul Kareem.